We will now listen to a number of talks given by representatives of the Flemish universities. And we had one person calling in ill yesterday, so that means we will be listening to five talks done by four presenters. And they will now take their seats behind the counter, hopefully. Let me see. This is to liven things up a little bit, see? Yeah, that's how it works. The speakers will briefly comment on the research regulations from their own university, and I would like to propose a slight change in the schedule because I would like to start with introducing Ann Peters, who will replace Stephanie van der Burgt in her talk on the comparative overview of university regulations. Let me introduce Anne. Anne Peters is a research director at the University of Hasselt, and she has a long-standing experience in the field of research coordination and played a key role in the shaping of the research policy at Hasselt University in recent years. And I think you must be ever so proud to be awarded for excellence in research at your university. So she will first take over Stephanie van der Burgt's talk on an overview of the university regulations. Anne.
Thank you, Pieter Nel. I was only asked yesterday to take over the speech of the presentation of Stephanie, so I didn't have the time to go in detail to all the different regulations of the Flemish University. So if I make some mistakes, please, colleagues. Well, the first setup of the debate of today was that we would present each of us our own regulations at our university, but we thought it would be more interesting if we gave an overview or a comparison of the different regulations at the five Flemish universities. And then later on, each of us will go more in detail on one of the subjects on scientific integrity at our universities. Now, for the comparison, we've seen that there are more similarities than there are differences between the different regulations at the five universities. And I will go step by step through the presentation and give you an idea. Then see how this works. Yeah. Well, speaking as Stephanie, I'll start with Ghent University then. For the composition of the Council for Scientific Integrity, Ghent University has a rather limited composition in number of members. They're listed above. So the members are appointed by the Research Council. They're permanent. There's a chairperson and a substitute, and there's a secretary from the Research Coordination Office. And the members are, if you compare it to the other universities, are quite limited. So one from the Alpha Sciences, one from the Beta, one from Gamma, and one of the Faculty of Law. KU Leuven is there. The committee is appointed by the Academic Council and under auspices of the Research Policy Council, the ROB, better known as ROB. There's a chairperson and also a reporting desk once again from the Research Coordination Office is Inge sitting here. The members are six members from Alpha, six Beta, six Gamma, and I understood there are three permanent and three replacing persons for each of this. There's one person from Lucas School of Arts, and there's one from Leuven Research and Development Office, and each file will also first go to an investigation committee before it's presented to the Council of Scientific Integrity.
It's not presented to the whole council.
Yeah. In a smaller group. Yeah. Yeah. The VUB has a slightly different regulations at the Free University of Brussels. There, the council is an ad hoc council, so it's not a permanent council. But in there, the council is appointed by the rector. So the expert panels are ad hoc, chosen ad hoc. And VUB is the only university where it is possible to have external experts from outside the university. There will be at least 5 experts in that field, and as always, one of the Faculty of Law. University of Antwerp, there the council is appointed by the board of directors. Again, there's a chairperson and a vice chairperson. And there's also a secretary, and it's also from the research coordination office. Yeah. The members are 3 professors emeriti, 1 of the Faculty of Law, and 2 members are in the field depending on the case that is presented.
Yes, the committee can be expanded if necessary.
Okay, and then for my university, the council is appointed by the College of Deans and is proposed by the Vice-Chancellor of Research, so the Vice-Rector Onderzoek. The council is permanent, has a chairperson, which in Hasselt, in our case, is Professor Molenbergs, who's present here. It has also a substitute chairperson and the secretary, which is myself. We have 3 members from science and technology, 3 members of medicine and life sciences, and 4 from law and economics. And 1 person of law is an advisory role as being a legal advisor. Okay, go for the scope of the committee. There are some slight differences in the scope, but they're not so many different than for other items of the Committee of Scientific Integrity. So for Ghent University, well, if you look at the scopes, it's mainly how a new case can be presented to the Council of Scientific Integrity. And for most of the universities, it's dealing with the research which has been done at the university of during the time that the researcher was bound to that university or is still present at the university. It's only at, one main difference is at the VUB. There can be, in the procedure of the Free University of Brussels, it's not so clear what the real scope is of the researchers at present at the university. So for instance, at Hasselt University, to give my the case of my university, so all violations originated or committed by researchers in the period and in which they were or are associated with Hasselt University or at one of the academic colleges, that falls within the scope of the Committee of Scientific Integrity. For the other universities, there's a slight difference. But for Leuven, it's the same. Antwerp, it's the same. For Free University of Brussels, it's not so clear how the scope is defined. Concerning the authority then, the procedures of Ghent, Leuven and Hasselt are very similar. There are some differences for the University of Antwerp and also again for Free University of Brussels. So for the 4 universities within the regulations or the bylaws of the Committee for Scientific Integrity, it's clearly defined that that we work within the Code of Ethics. This is not clearly defined in the regulations of the Free Universities of Brussels. So Brussels doesn't mention the Code of Ethics in their procedures at all. The other slightly differences are for Antwerp that concerning the disciplinary actions. So for Ghent, Leuven, Hasselt and the VUB, the work of the scientific and the Committee for Scientific Integrity ends with the advice. For Antwerp, there can also be disciplinary.
But suggestion, but then it goes to the university board.
Yeah, but for the other, there's no suggestion. There's either no suggestion. So they end with the advice that they state there is a case of violation or there's no case of violation. But there's no suggestion of or for an disciplinary action. Yeah. Then how can you make, as a researcher, a complaint to the Committee for Scientific Integrity? Also here we see some slight differences, but mainly similarities between the different universities. Everybody can file a complaint to the Committee for Scientific Integrity. at the University of Ghent, this can be done completely anonymous. For the other universities, this is semi-anonymous. This means that that the identity of the individual who puts a complaint is known to the committee, but it's not known to the person, to the researcher, where you have a case against. For the VUB, we don't have information on that. And then there's one different item for the KU Leuven, is that it's not that the complaint is not going directly to the committee of to the Committee for Scientific Integrity, but it goes first to the investigation committee. There's a difference between Leuven and the other Flemish universities. And then a last slide about some features which are different. So for all universities, for the whole procedure is a confidential procedure. Then for all universities, expert opinions can be asked during the procedures. For Ghent, there will always be hearing of the two parties, the two cases. For KU Leuven, Antwerp and Hasselt, this is optional. So there the chairperson can decide whether the researcher or the one who puts the complaint will be heard. There's also a right to reply, which was not found in the regulations of the Free University of Brussels, but for the other universities, there is a possibility to reply on the first report, and this reply is mainly in written. Substitution of conflict, if conflict of interest, also happens four out of the five universities. In Antwerp, that is not the case, because in the committee of Antwerp, they are mainly emeriti, professors, so there is no conflict of interest with the ongoing research in the laboratories. And then the last point is about public results or external communication. In Ghent, Leuven and Hasselt, most universities, so those three universities, take no further actions to make these results public. The results of the investigation done by the Committee for Scientific Integrity is not made public, unless with VUB and Antwerp. It's a president of the research council or director who have a responsibility in external communications. Okay.
I think Ans deserves a big round of applause for taking over on such a short notice. Next speaker from the Free University of Brussels is Chris van Schravendijk. He's director of the Doctoral School of Life Sciences and Medicine. Among many other scientific accomplishments, Chris wrote a book on scientific thought and integrity, and that's obviously an important aspect of the topic that you will talk about today. You will talk about scientific integrity in life and pharmaceutical sciences, I guess.
Indeed.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm not going to comment on the rules and regulations. I know that our rectorate is very hard working on this. It is a very important topic, but it's still a work in progress. So I will take the slide set of the previous speaker home and take it in as a possible tool for getting the procedures more clear. But what I would like to say about the life sciences angle, so the perspective on fraud in the life sciences, is a little bit a follow-up of the very first talk of this morning, which I liked a lot and I think is very relevant for my presentation in the next few minutes. And that is, first of all, that I am a teacher. Apart from director of the doctoral school, I'm also a teacher in the bachelor's. And since about 20 years, I have a true interest in the problem of fraud. And also with the link of science theory. And one of the most important papers that I read over the years is this Martinson paper. You can just type it in Google and have immediately the PDF. And I can only advise all of you, do it. Read a paper about fraud. And this is one of the best, I think. It's, for me, at least, it was an eye-opener. Because what in this paper of Martinson happened is actually you have a frequency of fraud of about, let's say, 0.2% of in this anonymous survey are the researchers that that seem to commit fraud. There's a difference between mid-career and early career, which I will comment upon a moment later. But what is most interesting is that there is a sort of a hierarchy of fraud. So the most serious ones are most low in frequency, and then they go up and up and up. And if you go to the tail of the table, you have 27% inadequate record keeping related to research projects. So I would recommend all of the students take a read of this paper and see what all these issues are, because for me it was the first time in my life that I was confronted with what we now call questionable research practices, which aren't good, but about a quarter of all the researchers commit them. So it's that was incredible for me. So for me that is the most important paper. That's my first notion. The second is that mid-career and advanced career scientists are more prone to commit integrity violations than early career. It's like if you see science as and the career in science as a rat race, like a marathon or marathon of Brussels or half marathon of Brussels, the real differences are not made at the start, but somewhere in the second half, you know? And so that is also something that you see that it's not a problem of doctoral students, it's a problem of professors also, and even more so. That's an inconvenient truth, but it seems to be true. So another thing is retractions, also mentioned by our first speaker. Retractions you can test, and I did an effort about 20 years ago to estimate the frequency of fraud, and I came after my reading of 1 out of 400 papers. And I just estimated the number of papers in PubMed that should deserve a retraction. So I estimated 50,000 retractions I should have. And then I went to PubMed and typed retracted publication, and I found quite recently, so 2,000. So that's 25-fold lower. But there is a catch-up in retractions. So more and more retractions more recently, and also the not only the best journals, the highest impact factor, but also a little bit lower impact factor journals start to retract papers. But it's has also been said by the first speaker, retractions are not only about bad let's say fraudulent science or integrity violations. There can be other reasons for retractions. And you can see here misconduct accounts for about half, it seems, in this Nature paper of 2011, and the rest is there is honest error, something like what Popper named error, trial and error. So a trial and error is not part of scientific frauds, but honest error, and then you have other issues. But more recently, there was another inconvenient publication. You can also have it for free and read it. Misconduct accounts for the majority of the retracted scientific publications. So 2 out of 3 retractions have to do with misconduct. And not only half, as was said in, so this is a year later. These are all studies, you know, but the good studies, the paper tips, I would call them. And then we had all kinds of fraud cases, like the one in the Netherlands. It's just one that I still read a Dutch newspaper here. And this is one page, terrible, November 2011, just a staff member, an established professor, and everything was wrong for many years. Doctoral students had to had to retract their papers in the social psychology. If you look at the properties of the account of the Lehfeldt Committee, I'm not going to go over all these. There's not enough time for it. But there is a lot of poor data handling. And that's why I liked so much the contribution of Professor Molenbergs, which underlined that you have to be very critical and careful with your data. This is the most important thing. And I hope that the next generation of researchers, so let's say you, will be in the future more proud about the analytical qualities of your papers rather than only the theoretical qualities of your paper. Let's say that is my hope. And if you look at these, so no access to primary data during analysis, one-to-one relationship between PhD student and promoter, no open discussion about fraud and data manipulation. This all comes from the Lehfeldt Committee. And you can find it easily back at this open access on the internet. You type Lehfeldt and Stapel, and you will find the report. Then, of course, this was also already presented by the first speaker of this session. What I would like to say about, before closing, what I would like to say about this is medical science is an applied science. The dream of the applied sciences is to find working solutions for medical problems. And one of the most important scientists in the history of science, Christian Huygens, said, I don't mind about my inventions, whether they are theoretically sound, but if it works, it must be true. Yeah, and that is a very nice instrumental idea about science. If it works, it must be true. Engineering sciences and the applied sciences. So very often it doesn't. And of course, this is also already mentioned, we are in the need of integrity codes, and they have to be broad, they have to be European, and not made ad hoc for particular cases. So already said. And then what can we do to prevent fraud? Maybe we can do some teaching, but let's please be careful about that. We organize on the 10th of June a conference in Brussels about the capacity and potential of the teaching as a prevention against fraud. And I think there also we have to be very critical, because there is some potential, but also maybe we shouldn't overestimate it. So, but read about modern science. It's fantastic to be a scientist and to make lasting contribution, but understand the process. And it's a complicated but fantastic process. And it's a great, one of the best jobs that you can have. So that's what I wanted to say.
Thank you, Chris. Well, Anne, of course, doesn't need any introduction anymore. And she will now continue with her own presentation on procedures when more than one stakeholder is involved. Yes?
Well, I didn't made a presentation on that because I was waiting what Olivier was going to tell in his presentation. So, because FWO is one of our stakeholders, so let me give you a few examples of a few cases of researchers that are present at our universities. For instance, you have a researcher appointed by University of X. He's working in a laboratory, biomedical sciences, which is linked to the VIB, the Flemish Institute for Biotechnology, and he or she has a postdoctoral scholarship from FWO. Each of these institutions has a committee for scientific integrity. So if there's a complaint against this researcher, who will take the lead? Which committee will take the lead? Another case. You have a researcher appointed, paid by the VIB, the Flemish Institute for Biotechnology. But he's working in a laboratory on the grounds of University Y. Again, there's a complaint. Who will take the lead? Because there's a committee for scientific integrity at VIB, and there's a committee for scientific integrity at the university. Third case, You have a professor, young professor, with an appointment of 40% at University X and 60% at University I. Why? Again, and this professor is also still has a postdoc position paid by FWO as sort of a tenure track, both sub position. This exists. These type of researchers are running around at the universities. Again, there's a complaint. Who will take the lead? So we had this discussion at the Vlier Council for Research, and the main concern of our people, the secretaries of the Flemish Committees for Scientific Integrity, but also for the vice rectors of research, is that we don't want that the complaint travels throughout Flanders, because there's no fire without smoke, you know? There's no smoke without fire, sorry. That's my English. Without too much coffee in the morning. So that's why we sat together also with the secretary of the Committee for Scientific Integrity at the VUB, because that is one of the SOCs who is really embedded in different Flemish universities. So we agree about procedures. So we said that the organization or the university has the lead in funding this research. So if he or she is on the payroll of that university or VEB, that committee will take the lead in investigating the complaint. The other committees or FWO itself will not investigate a complaint. We'll always look at the lead university or VEB in case the VEB is the employer. So what we agreed upon is that there will be who will take the lead in which case. There was no main discussion on that. And that we also will inform the others about it without giving too much detail. So that is very briefly what we agreed in Flanders.
Okay. Next speaker, Marianne de Voogd. She has a background in arts and humanities, especially in literature and linguistics, and in European studies. Being a member of the Ethical Advisory Committee at the University of Antwerp, she acts as an advisor on practical questions about scientific integrity. She will shed some light on the scientific integrity policy at her university and give us some facts and figures and also responses from the field, from her discipline.
Well, good morning, everyone. I will be talking about the concept of scientific integrity and fraud in the social sciences and humanities for the next 10 minutes. As I only have 10 minutes, I will make it very brief. I will firstly look into the Stapel case. So for those who were intrigued by the speech before, I will learn some more. Then I will go into some facts and figures about the occurrence of fraud in the social sciences and humanities. And I will end with some reactions of the field. So the Stapel case, there's a reason why both Chris and I mention it. It's still a very high-level case. It's one of the biggest cases, if not the biggest one, in the Benelux until now. It's about Diederik Stapel. He was a Dutch professor of social psychology at the University of Tilburg and also connected to Groningen and Amsterdam. That already shows a problem of what Olivier also mentioned of the track record of a researcher. If you have to investigate the occurrence of fraud and you have three different universities that have to work together. He was accused of not only falsifying his data at the beginning of his career, but also later on of fabricating his data. And it's high level because he was a very renowned scientist. He published in Nature very visible research also to the general public. And he was reported by two of his PhD students. They went about it very meticulously. They did not run into any accusations and let their own investigation before they reported it to the dean of their faculty. Then the Leveld Committee, it's one of the three committees that the case took over, and they saw that almost 55 or even more of the publications of Diederik Stapel, there have been occurrences of fraud or at least oddities that lead to the suspicion of fraud. What is interesting is that right after the publication of the report of the Levelt Committee, you got two opinions within the field of social psychology. On the one hand, you got a lot of social psychologists blaming their own discipline for being inherently faulty, so faulty at nature, and that something needed to be remedied. And then you had other social psychologists stating that in view of other disciplines, so they took the broader view in review of other scientific disciplines, social psychology is not at fault. Well, is Stapel representative for the occurrence of fraud in the social sciences and humanities? Well, up until now, we do not have a lot of numbers on the social sciences and humanities as such, but we have an interesting study by one of the big names in the concept of scientific fraud, a researcher named Daniele Fanelli, who in 2009 made a publication, a kind of meta-survey on other surveys that already had been performed, where they questioned researchers about their own experiences with research fraud, but also they had them report on what they saw with their peers. Now, if we look at the figures, we see that if they report about themselves, about 2% state that they have gone in for real big fraud, so the fabrication, falsification, and plagiarism, and about 32%, the numbers are higher always for the questionable research practices, so we see that it's about one-third of the researchers. Well, if they report about their peers, the numbers become higher. You get 14% for the big fraud, and up to 72% for the questionable research practices. Of course, you have to take into account some nuancing that often some cases, one case will be reported by many scientists. You get scientists tapping into societal expectations so that they will not state that they have committed fraud. So these are some numbers we can work with, but some nuancing has to be done. Now, what about the social sciences and humanities? Fanelli, in his paper of 2009, looks into it very briefly. He mentions that if you look at the social sciences compared to the biomedical sciences, there is no significant difference, so the percentages stay the same. But he does say that for the medical science, there is a significant difference. So the percentages go up with regard to fraud and questionable research practices as opposed to the biomedical sciences and the social sciences. Now, that was between different disciplines. Now, what within the discipline itself? Well, at the moment, as I said, we have no concrete data that we can work with. But what we do know is that there are some differences in the amount of positive results that are being put forward in publications. It has also been mentioned by the first speaker today that negative results are not as much published as positive results, and that they should be. Of course, if you have a positive result and your hypothesis is seems valid, that does not automatically mean that your data has been manipulated to make it so. Here again, we have to nuance it, because it might also just be that in the social sciences, the type of hypothesis or the scientific method leads to more positive results. Again, a paper of Fanelli, I said, big name. And he shows that for all the disciplines, if you take it as a general discipline, about 90% positive results are being reported. Well, for all the scientific disciplines, the number is very high. The lowest number is like 73%. So it's a lot, 90%, but it's not that much as opposed to the other disciplines. And within the discipline itself, it's mostly psychiatry and psychology that rank the highest. Now, what are some of the reactions of the field? Well, mostly it's not only social scientists that respond to scientific fraud, but we do see that social scientists are very prone for research into research integrity. They really go about to come up with qualitative data on scientific fraud, and it's really a new movement within the social sciences and humanities. Another reaction is that most of those scientists who do who perform research into research integrity, they publish open access, so they put their publications online, and there's also an inclination to put your data online so that other researchers can replicate your studies so that it can be proven true or false. Slightly linked into this is the concept of the Open Science Framework. It's partly a repository, but also partly a reproducibility project. So now they have one running on psychology. You can send in your papers, and then they will do a replication of your study so that you have proof that your hypothesis has been proved valid and that what you have stated in your paper is in fact correct. What is also interesting is that there now is in the social media, a lot of scientists are heading that way with blogs on scientific integrity. Retraction Watch has already been mentioned. You also at a certain time had scientific red cards, so really scientists looking out for occurrences of fraud. And finally, I will not go into them because they have already been discussed in detail. The Flemish universities, also the Walloon universities and European organizations are really looking into the concept of fraud and integrity, but at the moment we do not have specific procedures for the social sciences and humanities, and perhaps that's also a question for the debate whether we should do it by discipline or really as science as a whole. Thank you very much.
Our final speaker for this morning is Inge Lerouge. She will talk about the integrity policy at the University of Leuven. Inge is a staff member of the Research Coordination Office, and in this capacity, she informs researchers about good practices in research projects. Inge, we would like to hear how your office coordinates research and stimulates collaboration at Leuven, in the Leuven Association. And I hear Leuven offers courses in scientific integrity, so that might be most interesting.
Thank you very much. I've been asked to focus on training towards research integrity. In general, they speak about RCR, or Responsible Conduct of Research, and how can we promote RCR training. And I want to start my talk with some thoughts, some questions. What is the best content of RCR training? What is the best format, timing, frequency? Who needs training? Who can teach? What is the impact? But unfortunately, the answers are not yet clear so far. For example, the impact over the long term of RCR training is not yet clear. But nevertheless, the Flemish universities are taking up more and more an active role in promoting research integrity. As you can see on this slide, I summarized some recent initiatives on RCR training. For example, at the U Gent and the VUB, there is RCR training incorporated in Introduction Day or Introduction Week for doctoral researchers. And these sessions are not compulsory. At both universities, also new interactive RCR training modules are under construction for doctoral researchers. At the University of Antwerp, two info sessions for doctoral researchers, postdocs and professors were organized. They were also not compulsory. They organized also a doctoral day recently in February with a lecture on research integrity and also a panel discussion with representatives of the FWO and the VCWI. At the University of Hasselt, an RCR training for doctoral researchers was initiated within the doctoral schools, and this will be compulsory from next academic year on. And as I'm connected with the KU Leuven, I've been asked to go into more detail at the situation in Leuven. towards RCR training, we will follow a two-level approach. This means first level is a more generic level. During the first year of doctoral studies, we will organize a central university-wide lecture of 3 hours for all newly registered PhD students. And this will be compulsory for all these students. And this is generic lecture, the do's and the don'ts, definition of scientific misconduct, information on conflict of interest, responsible authorship, plagiarism, and so on. And then a follow-up workshop will be organized later in the doctoral trajectory in smaller groups, more interactive, with discussion of specific cases, and that these workshops will be organized then by the doctoral schools themselves. On the other hand, we also have bought 3 licenses of an online tool on research integrity that was developed by an English company called Epigeum. And we call the tool LIRICS. LIRICS stands for Leuven Institutional Research Integrity, Culture and Self-Reflection. And this tool is accessible for both senior and junior researchers of the KU Leuven via our Blackboard system that's called Toledo. And we installed the tool as a community on Toledo. And this is the welcome page of this community, LIRICS, and each researcher of the KU Leuven can then... Is there a pointer here? No.
Yeah. There's a pointer, the red one.
The red one. Okay, thank you. So each researcher can choose between one of the 5 discipline-oriented versions, depending of their interests. Each version contains up to 5 hours online study. And this is one version. That's the structure of one version, and it contains 5 modules, as you can see here. And what is interesting is that it also is related to the different phases of research. For example, a designing module, a conducting module, and a reporting module. In the introduction module, you can find more information on how to respond to research misconduct. Here in the brown box, you can find our KU Leuven policy documents, so our procedure for handling cases of misconduct. It's a very interactive tool also, as you can see here. For example, you can vote. There is a question with several answers, and you can choose one answer. And then you can also see the responses of other researchers on this question. Here you can see also the link to the Flemish situation, so the policy of the procedure of the VCWI. Another activity, for example, where you get a question and you can choose between different answers. You can drag the answer to the other side of the balance, and if you have chosen the right answer, then you will see an equilibrium here. Another module is the conducting module, with more information on the research record, research data, data interpretation. For example, here you can find what should be in your research record. You can also find some statistics. We already heard in a previous talk that over 25% of scientists admit to keeping inadequate research records. That's a real problem. Another module is then the reporting module, where you can find more information on plagiarism, on authorship, on peer review. For example, here you can see the page on plagiarism, where you find some statements of some controversial statements of people, for example, plagiarism doesn't actually hurt anyone. That isn't true. If when you click on this card, then it will flip and you will find some counter arguments, for example, that it really does hurt the author because you have stolen the ID of the author. So you can also find here our link to our policy on plagiarism. This is a useful interactive flow chart on plagiarism in the tool. For example, you can find do's and don'ts to avoid plagiarism. And then I want also to emphasize the important role of the supervisor. And we've just heard also about the Liefeld Commission, and one of its recommendations was important relationship between promoter and the PhD student. We have also a policy document at the KU Leuven that's called the Profile of the Good Promoter, and we adapted it recently, where we stated that the supervisor creates a research environment in which correct scientific behavior is the norm. So it is important that RCR, or responsible conduct of research, is also taught in the context of everyday practice of science. Another initiative of the KU Leuven was that we recently launched a new website on research integrity with some good practices related to publication, to data management, to disclosure of conflict of interest. You can also find a procedure for handling misconduct, and then also the integrity as a culture, where we have a link to the lyrics tool. And that's my last slide, where I want to mention that research integrity has become an integral part of the institutional research policy, so it is really important also at the policy level. It is one of the six spearheads in the research policy plan, the new plan of our new vice rector for research, and I think that's also an important step. That was it. Thank you for your attention.